And we have three excellent guests to help us along. To my far right is Dale Eisler, who is a senior policy fellow at the Johnson Shoyama Graduate School of Public Policy at the University of Regina, also a senior advisor on government relations to the university president. And before that, Dale spent a number of years with the Government of Canada in senior positions. Ingrid Thompson has had a long career of more than 20 years with various roles in the energy, environmental, and infrastructure sectors. Ingrid joined the pollution probe team in October of 2016. Before that, spent a decade consulting in Europe for a number of organizations, helping them to plan and navigate change and transformation programs. And Edward Greenspan has worked at the intersection of journalism and public policy for more than 30 years. He's currently president and CEO of the Public Policy Forum, and before that was the editor-in-chief of the Globe and Mail, capping off a long career as a journalist. So welcome to all of you. Thank you for being here.
Thank you.
And let's start the discussion by talking about how politics in Canada is shaping the conversation around energy and the environment. Dale, what are your thoughts?
Well, I want to say, first of all, I want to thank John Barrett, who's an old colleague of mine from PCO days and at Foreign Affairs for a time, for the invitation to be here. I really appreciate it. So politics shaping the debate on the environment and climate change. I think absolutely it is. I mean, there's an expression that public policy is the art of persuasion, and persuasion, politics is all about persuasion, right? And I think that what we've been witnessing in this country clearly has been the struggle of trying to reconcile the challenges that are inherent in the climate change debate, the energy and the environment, how do we reconcile these things. And we haven't been successful to date. It's been intermittent, our successes, but we're at what I think is something of a critical point. I'm really profoundly optimistic, or pessimistic, I'm sorry, about sort of the future in terms of a transition to a low-carbon economy, about our ability to get there, because I think it's inherently about our climate change policy. I mean, that's going to dictate how rapidly we move in the direction towards a low-carbon economy. And I'm of the view, others may not share it, but I'm of the view we haven't had anything approaching an honest or realistic debate about climate change policy in this country. We talk about this future of a low-carbon future and addressing climate change without sort of admitting that there are going to be wrenching changes that result from this. Our standard of living today, quality of life, has largely been based in many regards on a fossil fuel-based economy. And we're not going to move away from that without there being significant impacts on standard of living for Canadians. And nobody talks about that. It's always presented as kind of this painless transition to a better future to address climate change and other things. And I mean, we can't agree in this country on a $20 carbon tax, which will have virtually zero effect, no measurable effect, I don't believe, on carbon emissions. And as the other, the previous panelist said, we should be talking about a $200 a ton tax. If we really want to change behavior, because this is about changing people's behavior, and that requires significant changes to standard of living. So I think the politics around this issue is obviously fraught, and we have not had an honest public discussion about it.
Okay. Ingrid, how do you see politics affecting the discussion around the energy, the economy, and the environment?
So I agree with a lot of what Dale said in terms of, on the face of it, we do have enormous amount of challenge in terms of dealing with the climate situation. In fact, I think it was 2001, I was part of the team at the COP6 in The Hague, which is where, I had a front row seat to watching the wheels start to fall off, the attempt of, trying to create this global compact and collaboration. In a weird way, though, now I'm trying to rediscover optimism. And I was sitting in Europe working on change and transformation programs, which informs my view, by the way, of how this is going. when the Paris Accord happened. And I remember thinking at the time, well, that serves me right. I gave up too quickly. There are still measures and ways that we can make forward progress on a very complex and difficult file. And I think it's important to protect, notwithstanding all of the sort of data and figures and the hopeless case feeling that we get in this, protect that optimism, because that's how actually we drive change. I also think, I'm going to come at this from a very contextual level, and I'm going to, probably say some things that might seem a little challenging. But the biggest problem, I think, in this room that we have in getting to the foundation beneath the politics, our culture, our attitudes about things to do with energy, is that we come at this where an engineering culture, which is, by the way, about 12% of the population has the engineer mindset, that mindset is also what drives the policymaking function. It is not what the general population adopts. And so we don't understand, when we talk about this stuff, the biggest message I tend to have when you try to think about what is it going to take to change the politics is two things. One is, what do we want the politics to be? What, other than, yes, we want to have a carbon tax and we want to have all this stuff. That's a very, pragmatic first step. But we have to think, as the gentleman said this morning, about what's the end goal. And then how do we get there is where we have a fundamental disconnect. We do not get there by educating people about nuclear. I know that it feels like that's what we need to do. We need to change how they feel about it, right? And that's actually where we usually drop the ball. And I'm writ large, I was part of the energy sector for years. I've been to a lot of meetings like this. It's not just the nuclear industry, it's the energy sector, where we all get together in rooms with people that fundamentally agree with us, and we agree even harder, and then we don't go and talk into the other rooms. And I think that's also something that I want to throw out as a bit of a challenge. I represent the environmental sector. As CEO of Pollution Probe, I have repeatedly said, when asked and when not asked, if we want to hit our Paris Accord goals, nuclear's got to be part of the solution. And anyone who says differently just hasn't looked into the situation. So, the politics is challenging, but is it more challenging than any other, than the oil patch? Or, the politics of wind power has its own particular little fun twist. So there's a degree to which I want to say, yes, absolutely, we've got a difficult row to hoe. And I can also tell you stories, for example, if anyone who's around in the 1970s remembers the Green Revolution and a guy called Norman Borlaug, who came out of nowhere and stopped, no kidding, a huge part of Central Asia from starving to death. That's how we feel now. We feel like they felt, in 1968, when the population bomb came out and we had this hopeless situation that could not possibly be solved. Well, we're at the front end of that. So, whenever people sort of go, well, we're going to give up hope, too big a problem to solve, I kind of want to sort of counteract that a little bit, and I want to challenge a little bit. And especially for this room, there's innovations that we don't know yet that could show up. The shale gas revolution, by the way, showed up out of nowhere. I don't think anybody at the turn of the century went, we're going to get out of coal. And for the people who thought we did that for moral reasons, I challenge that a little bit. I'm glad we did. It's still not perfect. We still have ways to go to get our economy, into the place that we need it to be to solve our climate issues. And the only way that happens is if we keep the conversations going, but we keep the optimism, and we fundamentally get better at understanding what shifts attitudes and behaviors. I feel like I'm talking too much now.
So, Ed, I remember when you were on Parliament Hill covering politics, and is it...
That sounds like an indictment these days,
Yeah. But don't you wish you were still there on some days?
Some days, more so than others.
Is it politically more expedient to run against carbon taxes than to run in favor of a $200 carbon tax? Is that one of the problems?
Well, taxes is a dirty word, and made a dirty word, but I think that, that's not the frame that anybody should be wanting to have the discussion in, already. And I would say, I want to come to the general points that have been raised, but let me just start with the point that Ingrid raised. I see and have seen for a lot of years economists and engineers saying people have to understand the facts. And it's not incumbent upon people to understand the facts, actually. That's not completely their job. It's incumbent upon economists and engineers to understand people and the public opinion and that environment. And facts aren't necessarily what drive it. Stories drive it, and narratives drive it better. But the unwillingness in some ways to kind of bend to facts. So I was, you know, you were kind enough to read out only part of my very long CV that, you know, you said that Ingrid had a long career, which makes mine, you know, excruciating. But I want to point out,
by the way, that you have your handwritten notes, and she has,
you know, because she's
handwritten,
you know,
notes on her iPad. She's
more digital. I try not to use dead tree. It's in my sector. We try to avoid dead tree as much as possible.
It's more environmentally.
But there's still
exactly.
So in my last job before I came to the Public Policy Forum, I was global managing editor for energy and environment for Bloomberg News, and one of the things I was leading coverage on was the Keystone. Pipeline. And, you know, the Keystone Pipeline was lost in Nebraska in 2011 because with a pro-pipeline governor who had a political problem around an aquifer, and you had to move the pipeline around the aquifer, and it was going to cost $100 million, and the engineering mindset was that's $100 million wasted because there's no danger here. But for $100 million, actually, if they'd listened to politics, they would have had Keystone approved while Hillary Clinton was still Secretary of State. In at that point, so you know that's point one. I'd say when you talk about the politics of the country, I guess I'd say you know the country is riven by energy debates. The country is seriously divided, perhaps more seriously divided than it has at any time since the National Energy Program. And I mean a series of debates, and it's not necessary, you know. So we have, you know, Alberta versus Canada, and we have echoes of, you know, Bristol Aerospace and Canadair, if people can remember the rise of the Reform Party and those issues in what's going on. I've spent a lot of time in British Columbia and Alberta recently. And actually there is a base of support in BC for economic development. But it's people aren't listening. It's probably not through the middle of Vancouver Harbor. And Liberal government isn't listening either, because it's probably up north, you know, where people are accustomed to brownfields and where you have, you know, straight out to sea makes it much easier. So we have all these divisions. We also have, I think, a very hopeful vision, if we could get it to a vision. And that's around electricity and clean electricity, and being a global clean electricity leader, and we obviously have a great head start on that from natural advantages and engineering advantages. And the idea of taking this electricity and working a story that's a Canadian story and that ties in from province to province and that builds economic development around it rather than just exporting, you know, it raw is a positive image. I think there's also a positive image, quite frankly, in oil. Gas is easier, but in oil, indeed, in that, I'm just going to use this analogy, and then I will turn it back. General Motors, you know, has said that its bet on the future, which is exceptionally bold, is that we're going to have electric cars, we're going to have autonomous connected cars, and we're going to have shared cars. And we got to get from here to there. And the way we're going to get from here to there is selling gas-guzzling SUVs and light trucks. We're going to buy change through. And so what are we saying in the oil economy? We're saying we want to continue to produce it, but what's the vision of where we want to get and how we want to use that money and how we want to use that advantage? And I think there's a story there and a story built on policy, not built out of thin air, that can be can be written.
But like, who do we tell that story to is part of the question here, because I find that when I'm not sure what people mean when they tell me that, you know, we have a politics problem. Do you mean you're not getting the meetings with the people that you want to have meetings with? Does it mean you have a specific vision for, like, I don't know, SMR reactors, and that's not getting taken up? Or do we mean we want to reunite a very divided Canada behind a common vision for energy? I think that's a very high bar to try to get over. So, you know, I feel like the way the conversation for this industry should go is, what is a realistic, you know, end goal, and what is the next step towards that? And I don't hear, like, I hear that in the energy sector a lot. I was at a conference a few months ago, and literally, like, the nuclear, the, you know, the guy who was there to talk about SMRs was like, okay, everybody, just get behind me. We can solve all your problems. Then I went to the next meeting, and the storage guy was like, hi, everybody, just get behind me. We'll solve your problems.
But that's the problem with your low bars. If you could take all these low bars that we have to get over and keep tripping out, mm-hmm. and perhaps have them under a vision that might be that people can wrap their pro-Canadian, pan-Canadian view of wanting to be leaders in the world, et cetera, around, then I think you've created the conditions to begin to get over your low
and
bars.
I think politically it's the ability to identify and express the national interest, which I don't think we hear well in a political sense, right? About, yes, there are all these sectoral and regional interests, right? Mm-hmm. But there's something above that. There is a national interest. And what is that? And how do these pieces fit together? We're not all going to get what we want. That's not the way the world works. And we have to recognize these inherent tensions that exist out there. So it's got to be kind of the political leadership to rally Canadians to some higher ideal that they can relate to.
Right.
Like in the West these days, and I live in Saskatchewan, and so I can't speak for, you know, the West is kind of it's an interesting place. It's a unique region, I think, but it's not a united region either.
Right.
Saskatchewan and Alberta are quite similar in terms of their interests when it comes to these kind of energy issues. It's quite remarkable. BC it's got more people there feel they have more in common with Washington State than they do with Alberta or the rest of the West. Saskatchewan people feel fairly connected to Alberta and not so much Manitoba. But at any rate, I think that people should not underestimate the sense of alienation that exists in Western Canada these days. And I don't want to go off on a tangent here, but I've got this sort of, the roots of this go back to the very beginnings of the West. And people who settled the West were actually pursuing the American dream when they came. It was about equality, opportunity, work hard, you'll get ahead, you'll succeed. It doesn't matter where you came from, what your background is, who you are, that doesn't matter. You work hard, you'll succeed, right? A very sort of individualistic kind of ethic to the West, whereas in Central Canada, it was about the accommodation of rights, largely French and English, so group rights. That mentality doesn't really exist, particularly on the prairies. And I think that fundamentally, you know, creates a disconnect in the national political discussion.
That's a values differential,
yeah,
right? And those values, by the way, this is you know, a big part of what drives change. Values are only shifted by one thing, and it's storytelling that gets down to the level of emotion. And the people who are least equipped to drive that kind of exercise, unfortunately, are engineering cultures,
yeah,
right? So this is where I'm going to keep, like, I feel like I'm pointing out some simple things.
But I think a lot of values are rooted in geography. You know, I had a premier of Quebec who said to me once that, now a former premier of Quebec, a recent former premier of Quebec, just to sort of give it away, who said that, if Alberta had hydro and we had oil, you know, our values would be different. You know, of course they would be different, right?
Sure.
And, you know, in BC and Alberta, you know, I think that there are economic interests that can be reconciled. I think you can see it around the LNG plant in some ways, because, you know, if gas is going to come, you know, there's an economic benefit there that derives big time to British Columbia, which isn't really true of the pipeline. And Alberta gets some of that economic benefit too, because some of the gas will come from Alberta. And I think we have to figure out how we can tie the interests of provinces together.
So on that, Ed, how do you make it not a zero-sum game? Because that seems to be what it is between Alberta and BC right now, right? And I think a lot of people would like to know how to align the interests of those two provinces. Jagmeet Singh would like to know, for example.
Well, to start with, you know, there's no monolith anywhere, and that would include British Columbia. So,
right.
You know, the Lower Mainland is not not necessarily the North. And one of the, you know, anomalies of British Columbia politics at the moment is that the NDP government, which normally has seats up north, has basically all its seats in the Lower Mainland. So it doesn't have that, I'm going to call them brownfield ridings type of representation. But it still has that mentality, and I think the Premier has that mentality, and that's why I think why he's pro-LNG, and I think that's why he went along with the Site C dam. So I think there's ways to reconcile. You know, a way to reconcile perhaps that's probably just not make any economic sense is to have a refinery in, you know, but who would build a refinery in this day and age when we're 20 to 40 years, you know, from the economic end of oil? That, you know, that wouldn't make sense. And that's why I sort of think ultimately it's about, you know, creating a set of policies that are about the transition and create present advantages for future advantages that can be shared, you know, both ways.
Yeah.
So that's how you unzero sum it.
Okay. Ingrid, what do you think a low carbon economy looks like? What's your vision for a low carbon economy and how?
Yeah, so I've been at a lot of sessions today, and I just have to say, we're talking about we're asking if a low carbon economy is desirable. And I want to say, like, who doesn't support peace in the Middle East, right? Of course, we all want to see a low carbon economy happen. And of course, nuclear is part of that. Again, repeatedly, I've said this, running an environmental NGO. You know, beyond that, I think we have to be honest that we don't have a clear project management style course for this change. And the reason I say that, again, I've been involved in change programs a lot, and there is a fundamental difference between change and transformation. Change, you can see every step of the journey and you can figure out, you know, what is it going to take to get to the next step. Transformation is like an explosion that you trigger and then you have to surf it. And, you know, whether we're going to get to a low carbon economy by incremental changes and by bringing in new things, or we have some transformative technology that shows up, and it could be a nuclear technology that shows up. You know, it's really hard to say. We do know that there will be more electrification. Pollution Probe, we do a lot of work, and shout out to Bruce Power, who's our supporter and partner on this, in the area of electrification of transportation, electric vehicles specifically. You know, I totally agree with your cognitive dissonance, shout out to GM on this, but like we know now, because passenger vehicle manufacturers have to tool up their production lines 3 to 5 years out, we know electric vehicles are going to be a much bigger factor, and it's not going to be a linear change. That's not how change works often. So, you know, a lot of the negativity that we have about how we're going to reach our low carbon economy, you know, I want to acknowledge it as a complexity problem, and as a lot of people in this room are going to be involved in banging their heads against a lot of that complexity. You know, there is a scenario in the, you know, where we do not, where we just fall back. My job and the people in my sector are working really hard to, you know, take advantage of that foundation that exists out there in public opinion, and it's strong.
Right.
Right? It's strong. People, you know, one thing I was talking to the gentleman from Abacus Research about, young Canadians do not believe that they will have the opportunity that their parents' generation had. They do not believe that they will be able to retire with the kind of lifestyle that their parents have. And still, they feel like climate change is a problem worthy of sacrifice and investment. How much is a tricky question, but, you know, that to me is a foundational opportunity. And, you know, we can get into the, you know, the complexity of regional disparities in Canada and, you know, the NIMBY problem and all that stuff. But, like, the starting point, the foundation has to be, what are our attitudes and what are our values? Again, getting to a low-carbon economy, I can't tell you, and I don't think, again, remember, we couldn't tell you in, you know, as the turn of the century that we'd get out of coal the way that we did. Mm. And we didn't know that, you know, the Ohio Valley would, you know, turn over in the matter of years from coal to shale gas. So, you know, all I can tell you is we have an imperative. The imperative is something that, you know, is fairly generally, you know, a peace in the Middle East question. And I don't think it's an if. I think it's a when and a how. And there's a degree to which we have to accept that, you know, and it's hard in an industry where your, you know, your threshold of investment is 30 to 50 years. I want to acknowledge that. There's no way you can be protected from all of that risk. But for, you know, for the basics of what does a low carbon economy look like, for the foreseeable future, it will involve quite a lot of nuclear. Renewables, you know, are, you know, part of the picture. Are they the, as much of the picture as, again, our, you know, general voting population thinks it is or wish it to be? No, it's not.
Dale?
Well, yeah, Ingrid, I want to be optimistic, and yeah. Hopefully we're going to move forward. I just have a hard time getting there. When I just sort of look around, like what the landscape in Canada, what's happened in recent years in terms of, you know, the attempt to have a pan-Canadian framework on climate change and whatnot, how difficult that's become, and how it's really kind of shifted in the other direction in terms of electorally what's happened in the country. And there could be more of that in the future. The United States, the election of Donald Trump and his immediate withdrawal from the climate, the Paris Accord, right? We've had climate agreements, global climate agreements for almost 30 years at different intervals and made virtually no progress because they're all aspirational documents and non-binding. And while we have made some incremental progress in terms of lowering our carbon emissions, our emissions are still growing rapidly. And I don't see the public will to actually tackle this issue. And then when you think of Canada in terms of where we, I think we produce 2% of global emissions, something to that effect, and the oil sands are half of 1% or whatever of that amount, right? People sort of instinctively know that what we do is so marginal, almost no measurable effect on global emissions, even if we reach our targets, right? So it's such a big policy challenge, and we talk about it, I go back to my first point, in unrealistic terms in that we are not actually telling people the truth. If we want to do this, there are going to be wrenching changes to our economy and society. There will be big changes. And your standard of living is going to be affected. That's what it's going to take. We have to change behavior of people,
yep.
Right? And we're not even close to getting that. Now, I think nuclear is a part of the solution, absolutely. Small modular reactors, absolutely. I know in Saskatchewan, I think SAS Power, I know they're involved. There's research being done, a multidisciplinary research at the University of Regina and Saskatoon through the Fedoric Center on SMRs. And SAS Power and the government of Saskatchewan is on the advisory committee, I believe, for the work. So, like, things are happening, but it's so incremental, so small,
and the problem is so big.
I want to be outlandishly optimistic for half a second, against your like really depressing pessimism. Dale and I have known each other for many years.
We worked
on the Regina Leader Post together, so I've been subjected to this pessimism for like decades. I actually think that there has been a tremendous amount of change. Ingrid was sort of alluding to the technology adoption curve before. And, you know, it's incremental until it's not incremental in a sense. And so what we have is we don't have a lot of change on the policy side. We have a lot of change on the market side. And that change has been induced by policy changes mm-hmm. or encouraged in some ways. So, you know, we have wind prices that have, you know, fallen radically. We have solar prices that have fallen radically. We have not yet the technological breakthrough in storage, but, you know, an amazing amount of work that's happening. We have car companies, you know, betting their futures on electric rather than on internal combustion. We have whole bunches of things going on, and we are, I think, telling the wrong story about this when we talk about carbon taxes and carbon pricing and this. What people experience is weather. And I know you can't associate any given weather event to
we're getting
whatever.
Better. The science is getting better. Yep.
But when you have like, you know, 5 once in a century things and like in 10 years or 20 years, and when you have the mini things, you know, I live mostly in Toronto, and you know, you get a little windstorm comes through and it lasts, you know, an hour and it closes down the airport. And it knocks down all kinds of trees. And you go, I don't remember that happening 10 or 20 years ago. And you have people who are saying, I'm going to buy a cottage. And they go, I don't know if I should buy a cottage because I don't know if that lake, or I don't know if I should buy a ski pass because I don't know if that's happening. So I think people are relating to something that's changing.
I agree.
And the markets are setting the conditions that we can actually have economical change. Even the SNRs are, you know, part of that. Technology is creating new possibilities, right?
I got to say, in 1996 was the first time I sat in a policy meeting about climate change. I don't know how much earlier you guys would have tripped across this. So, you know, we have actually, you know, at least the problem at least is broadly accepted as the problem. I do agree that there is work to do to get people rallied behind I should even bother doing something, right, because there is this sort of pedantic pessimism that I struggle with myself. But I don't know if this is any relief to anybody in the room. I was in a meeting with a bunch of my people in the environmental sector, and a really smart guy looked at me and said, I'm not worried about energy. Energy will have some innovation that will come along within the next 20 years, and right, it will be, you know, a magic bullet, at least one magic bullet, that will get us out of the energy side of the climate problem. The real issue you should be worried about is water. That's going to be the real, you know, stinky mess problem. And I don't disagree with that. I feel like, you know, we are having the conversations. I do wish these conversations went outside of the walls of these kinds of rooms more. And, you know, again, the politics of this, I was speaking with John earlier, and I said, well, tell me what your political problem is exactly, so that I can, you know, speak to that more intelligently. And poor John, I'm going to put you on the spot a little bit. He said, well, you know, we go to meetings and they say we don't want to have anti-nuclear activists. And my response is, okay, I'm an environmentalist. Point me towards a kind of energy that does not have opposition, does not have people, right, you know, willing to go out and pick it and oppose it and whatever. That is not a realistic objective. Yeah. So, you know, again, there's a much bigger, more complex backdrop, and I like to make things really, really simple. One thing I go back to, and I crowdsourced this on social media yesterday just to make sure I'm not lying. I asked when the last time in the zeitgeist, which is informed by stories, when was the last time a television or movie that we sit and watch with our families and the regular people out there that vote, when was the last time that a nuclear disaster was the bad guy? And we found one, the Chernobyl Diaries, about 4 years ago, but it wasn't really about the nuclear, it was the post-nuclear backdrop for some sort of horror story. Other than that, you gotta go back to like 1984, or even further back to the China Syndrome. While we were all busy talking about the technical and political and whatever issues, the foundational pieces beneath our political discourse, the zeitgeist, the things that people stay awake and worry about, shifted from being about a nuclear disaster to being about climate change. There was an article in the Literary Review of Canada exactly about this topic. So, you know, as hard as it is to be optimistic, I just want to go back to that the values foundation is actually geared the right way for us to start, you know, being more optimistic about finding solutions. That's the starting point. That's the bedrock beneath everything else.
Okay, so let's talk a little more about politics, though, because this is an election year in Canada. Are we going to be talking about climate change in September and October, or are we going to be talking about other things? And are some people going to be avoiding the topic? Are some people going to be embracing it? What do you think, Ed?
Oh, we're going to be talking about it. I mean, you know, let's leave aside the events of the last 24 hours or week and a half or wherever you want to put it, and, you know, let's say we're into the normal kind of election discourse. So, you know, conservative parties, as Dale was saying before, have been fairly successful running against carbon taxes, and in the last election, the Liberal Party won the election based on a high turnout of millennial votes. Millennials in this election are the largest voting bloc, larger than baby boomers for the first time. So the largest voting bloc, and, you know, there's a value system there around climate and carbon. So I think that both parties are going to have an interest. I can't figure the NDP, you know, where it will play in. Obviously, the Liberals and the NDP will be fighting over switching votes, but they both have an interest in wedging those issues, so I think they will.
Okay. Dale, you
agree?
Yeah,
no, I agree with that. I'm certainly it'll be on the agenda, and how pivotal it will be remains to be seen, because who knows what else is going to, you know, emerge, and whether it'll be a ballot question, the climate change issue. I don't know. I tend to think not, but it could. It could, and I agree with Ed about the millennials. This is the future. These are the people that are going to drive, I think, policy going forward. But of course, young people get old like us, and, you know, change their views too. So, you know, every young generation, right, is more progressive in its thought traditionally, and then they become old and regressive. So we'll see.
I just think that their views fall out of fashion. I don't think they change them.
Yeah, I don't think, I disagree.
Well, I don't know. I know a lot who certainly have changed their views, but I remember them, what they were at one time, and they certainly aren't anymore. Mm. But, you know, this is anecdotal stuff.
Ingrid, is there an opportunity in the this year's federal election?
Okay, well, to answer your first question, it is going to be part of the discussion, even if it's, you know, wedgily used as a way for people in, especially
but,
Alberta.
But let me jump in, because maybe I should be more specific. I'm sure climate change will be part of the discussion, but what does that mean, right? Are we just going to be talking about carbon pricing, or is it going to be a more sophisticated discussion around energy policy?
Well, good luck with that. I mean,
exactly. Yeah.
I haven't seen the problem with our energy debates is fundamentally a misunderstanding again of what the voter relationship. When you try to do that thing that we always do, where we go, we just need to educate you. We just need energy literacy. That's the way this is going to work. 20 years in this sector, I keep going, they want the switch to flip on, they want their bill to be manageable, and they want to know...
They want other people to be experts about it,
right?
Not to be
but,
experts
but we
themselves.
Do dumb things in that context, right? I think the what to do and how to solve the problem is definitely something that is going to be used and abused by, you know, the populist views that just go, well, call anything a tax, and people are going to be annoyed about it, especially in... you know, places where there's, economic decline. So, but, you know, again, I go back to this, guys, like especially the youth, but it's not just young people that go, you know, climate change is a table stake. If you're not willing to take this on and agree that we need to do something about this, whatever political party takes that view is stuck in your four-year election cycle, and it's a short-term win possibly, and a long-term, you know, definitely
sure.
poor position. And the voices, you know, I'm not, my organization isn't necessarily one that, gets into the fracas of election debate necessarily. We provide policy recommendations and solutions, but I sit next to a lot of those people and they're not gonna sit on their hands. How much attention they're gonna get, different question. But like, there's definitely gonna need to be a better thought process about how to engage the voter on this.
I think there's a really key point there that I agree completely that, the conservative, there's two conservative positions out there, and the Conservative Party conservatives are fighting about this. You know, one is like a Preston Manning-like position, and the other is let's say more Doug Ford-like.
And they're not friends.
But one is just a very short-term position, because if you're not going to win millennial voters, you know, and it's attached to affordability, obviously, and the anxieties that people have about affordability and the future of work and matters like that, which are very genuine. So, you know, you can say carbon tax, and people, you know, get scared because they can't make ends meet as it is. When you talk about, you know, people and their bills, you know, the moment about the election that was most interesting to me occurred in January 2018, which was when Trudeau went on the road to do a town hall when everybody was going all about the Aga Khan, and he went to a town hall and a woman was there with her Ontario Hydro bill, and she was in tears and she was trying to pick, you know, I either pay my bill or I feed my kids, you know. That's what goes on for a lot of people, and therefore they're vulnerable to, you know, different kinds of appeals. But that's not a long-term play.
Yeah.
Well,
cool.
And I got to say, sorry, can I just finish?
Very quickly. We're way over.
So yeah. My time in the electricity sector in Ontario, we've been through this three times where what good policy is to get true cost pricing. We're going to raise the price of electricity to what it actually costs. Three times this has been battled back. So another thing I want to just throw out there, and it's a little bit of a crazy idea for people, is price response is not a great primary and only tool to drive behavioral change. We rely on that, and we kind of forget that there's all this other stuff that needs to happen if you want to change behavior.
Okay.
And, you know, anyways.
So we have time for maybe one or two questions before we wrap up. If you have a question, put up your hand. We'll get a microphone to you. I do want to make sure we include the audience in this discussion. Okay, we've got a question right up here in the front. We'll get a microphone to you from your right. It's coming right over there. Go ahead.
Hello, thank you for the very interesting talk. I'm Jason Song from RMC. I'm a student. I just have a question regarding something that I believe was mentioned briefly by Dale, that Canada, in the global scale, accounts for less than 1% of the entire carbon dioxide emission. So in listening to that, I can't help but to think that, we are a first world nation with a lot of technology that could, you know, lead the change of example, but at the same time, it really isn't up to us to make the impact, but the rest of the world that is in the developing economies that is primarily relying on fossil fuels. But I find that's a very difficult moral question because us, having gone through that industrialization, has reaped that benefit of having burned fossil fuels for the past, God knows how long, half a century. And who are we to tell these countries like China, India, who are lifting people out of poverty at unprecedented rates, for them to, let's say, stop and then stop burning fossil fuel and then injecting carbon dioxide into the air. How do you deal with that?
Yeah, I mean, I think
very quickly.
I think that's a spot on question, and the whole moral issue about us as a developed world saying to these people, well, I'm sorry, you can't utilize cheap energy like we did, fossil fuels, coal, and other things to get the standard of living we have. You got to somehow make the leap into the new economy. It's a nice thought. How that happens is beyond me. And I think it really is a big moral dilemma for us in the developed world to expect that of other people.
This was, by the way, one of the big reasons why the wheels fell off in COP6. Mm. One of the divides was developing versus developed world and, you know, carbon sink versus, you know, economies that didn't have carbon sinks available. There are so many of those reasons why this isn't going to happen, because it is a global collaboration. The opportunity, though, that goes with this is you have to remember the airshed for greenhouse gases is the world, the globe, right? One of the policy tools that was developed that was supposed to be able to reduce costs and take advantage of that and, you know, drive some benefit to the developing world was cap and trade. There are good things and bad things, and there certainly are a lot of complexities to that policy, but that's something that you should look at as a tool that if you want to support a way of making it easier for the developing world to get on board and avoid falling into the traps that we have. That was a policy that was effectively geared towards that.
Okay, we're going to have to stop there, but a big thank you to Dale, to Ingrid, and to Ed for being on our panel. Very interesting. Thank you. Sure. Great to have your insights on this.